If you're not willing to be involved in these rehabilitation programs, then you might get one crack at parole and that's it, because that change is directly relevant to your ongoing risk to the safety of the Victorian community.
In 1993, Paul Denyer stalked the seaside Melbourne suburb of Frankston for 7 weeks, violently murdering 18-year-old Elizabeth Stevens, 22-year-old Deborah Freem, and 17-year-old Natalie Russell.
When I saw the marks on the body, they were unusual, and there is a history of that type of behaviour with serial killers. So I was immediately alert to the potential for something worse to come.
The mood in Frankston at the time was everyone was in fear. We didn't really know exactly what was going on.
The fact that you can't even go down to your local milk bar without being attacked is now very serious in this area.
Initially sentenced to 3 life terms without parole, on appeal, that was reduced to 30 years. His first parole application last month was rejected.
If ever I've seen a person who doesn't deserve freedom, it's Paul Denyer. He'll never not be a risk to the community.
Denyer's victims' family and friends still suffering the scars of his horrific crimes, re-traumatised by his bid for parole.
This person really shouldn't be released.
He just needs to stay there.
The government today flagging a law change so serial killers and violent offenders can only apply for parole every 5 years once eligible.
An amount of time will have to pass before you're able to reapply. That will either be 5 years or perhaps longer.
One-off laws already mean Russell Street bomber Craig Minogue and Hoddle Street killer Julian Knight will probably never be paroled. The state opposition demanding the same for Denyer.
Anything that allows him to have an application for parole in the future is spitting in the face of the families, a disgrace, and ignoring those communities of Frankston and Seaford who have had to live with 30 years of pain.
Well, joining us now is veteran crime writer John Sylvester, who's also produced a doco on Denyer. John, you reported on these horrific crimes. What was that time like in Melbourne?
The whole area of Frankston was in virtual lockdown for 7 weeks. 3 women were murdered by Denyer in that time. Shopkeepers were walking women to their cars. There was general warnings because this man was just hunting women. There were 3 other women in that time who, just by pure fluke, weren't victims. Denyer would later tell police that he'd wanted to kill women since the age of 14 and had been stalking women since he was 17. So that was 4 years. So there are hundreds of women in the Frankston area that wouldn't have known that they were followed, and just the time wasn't right, a car went past, he wasn't in the mood, and they escaped, where these poor 3 women didn't.
John, the government has known about this. They knew it would be an issue for, what, 30 years? Why haven't they been better prepared?
Well, I think nobody really believed that Denyer would get parole. Let's just remember that the original judge, the very great Frank Vincent, gave Denyer life with no minimum. It was only on appeal he got 30 years because he was 21 at the time. During his time in prison, he's done none of the required courses to get parole, but he reached his minimum, so he was entitled to go for parole. Didn't mean he was going to get it, and the parole board knocked him back. And I understand they've said, you're not even close.
Even if violent offenders have done the courses, I mean, previously, offenders like Jill Mars killer Adrian Bailey admitted that he'd gone through the motions of rehabilitation to secure early release. So can the government ever make sure that offenders properly engage with rehabilitation programs, or is that impossible?
Personally, I think Denyer should never get out. The reason being, he will create enormous concern to the victims' families, to the broader community. He can't be trusted. And in that case, it's not a matter of punishing Denyer. Who cares? It's about protecting the community. And nobody can say he's not a risk. Therefore, he remains where he belongs, in prison.
John, really appreciate your time tonight. Thanks.
Good on you. Thank you.